To the Lord today. Come on, you sing, I will bless.
I will bless the Lord at all times.
Come on, I think you got a little bit more down deep inside. Let's go, I will bless him.
I will bless the Lord.
That's it, come on, now you got it. Everybody together sing.
I will bless the Lord at all times. He's good.
Yes, we're gonna bless the Lord today. I will bless
him. I will bless the Lord at all times. He's good.
Come on. Don't you know he's good?
He's good.
Real good.
So good.
So good.
Real good. And every day of my life, I'll bless the Lord. He's good.
Yes, he's good. Come on, sing. I will bless the Lord.
I will bless the Lord at all times. He's good. Declare.
Jesus is Lord.
Don't stop praising him. Come on, there's freedom in the house today. Come on. Freedom in this place. Freedom in this place. Just declare that with us. Because I declare freedom for my family. And I declare freedom for my home. I declare freedom for my daughters, and I declare freedom for my son. I declare what your word has spoken, no matter what I feel or what I see. I declare every chain is broken, we're gonna be free. One more time, come on. As I declare freedom for my family. That's it. I declare freedom. Come on, church, declare it. I declare freedom for my daughters. I declare freedom for my son. I declare what your word has spoken. No matter what I feel or what I see, I declare every chain is broken. Gonna be free. Gonna be free. Just lift your worship up to him. Come on. We worship you today, Jesus. Worship you, Jesus.
Just lift your hands like free people this morning. Just lift your hands like you're free. Just got set free. I was in sin's prison. Oh, so dark and cold. Just a lost sheep wandering from God's eternal fold. Then the door swung open, and Jesus said to me, I have signed your pardon. You may now go free. Jesus signed my pardon. This I surely know. He took my place at Calvary. Now I don't have to go. All my life I'll give him, for he gave his for me when he signed my pardon there at Calvary. I want you to begin this new year by just simply praising him and thanking him and worshiping him for the fact that his blood has set us free. Amen. We don't deserve to be free, but his blood has set us free. There's freedom in the blood of Jesus. Freedom in the blood of Jesus. There's freedom in the blood of For it washes white as snow. There's freedom in the blood. We say thank you, Jesus. Freedom in the blood. Oh, hallelujah. For it washes white as snow. Well, praise God. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for the close of a year and the beginning of a new one. We thank you for this year that stands in front of us. And I pray that each and every one of us will follow your steps. For you said the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. And I pray that you'll order our steps and we'll be faithful to follow them. Would you move in this service, saturate each and every one of us. May your presence be sensed and felt in a new and fresh way. We don't presume upon anything today, God. We don't presume upon you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.
We don't expect you to do what we want. We're going to find what you want. So I pray that our spirits and minds and hearts would be keen and acute to your voice. speak to every person, God. Not just one, not just two, but may each and every one of us leave this place knowing that you've spoken directly to our hearts. I pray that every plan, every purpose, and every scheme of the devil would be defeated, and that your name would be glorified in all that's said and all that's done. In Jesus' name, let God's people say amen. Give someone a hug, please, please. They need to know they're loved, and you need to let them know it. You may be seated. So thankful for each of you that are here on this first day of the year, and thankful for so many that are online. I know a lot of people were traveling, a lot of people sick. There's some pretty big things going around. I got a text this morning. A family said we're sick. We'll be online. That's the beauty of the online. We probably have about as many online today as what we do in the sanctuary. It's one of those days, but I'm not going to lament over who's not here. I'm going to be thankful over who I have here, and that's you. And we're glad that you're here. And would you welcome our online congregation and thank them for being with us as well. Thank you wherever you are. And we pray that God's choice blessing would rest upon you. Well, would you put the number up? If you're visiting with us for the first time, or you're online for the first time, or you've been coming for some time, and you haven't been getting any of our emails, I want you to text your email to this number, and we'll be able to reach out to you in this new year, and you can find out more about what's going on at the church and find out more about what's going on. We're going to be talking to here shortly. Went a month and a half, couple of months there, haven't talked about the new building for a while. Just kind of gave that a rest. You know, you talk about those things sometimes, and money and things like that, and people think, well, that's all they are about. Well, that's not what we're all about, but it does take money. And but the new building, we're going to get some footage and some pictures and show you. You're going to be amazed at how it's coming along. It's phenomenal, the progress that's being made right now. And they've got the sanctuary laid out, where the risers are going to be, the stadium seating. It's all cemented. Someone even put my name in the cement. It wasn't me. Everyone thought I did it. I didn't do it. They wrote Troy right there in the cement. They didn't put Ervin. They should have put Ervin to specify to make sure it was me. But they put my name in the cement, and that just ensured the fact that you'll never get rid of me. Even if you get rid of me, I'm always going to be there. I'm in the concrete. But we're excited about it. I can't wait for you to see some of the footage. It'd be hard for everyone to walk through. It'd be the hazards of it. We can't do that. But we're going to go over and get some pictures and some footage and let you see here in the next week or so everything that's going on. It is extremely exciting. And to think here in just a few short months, we're going to be having church off of Milford Parkway, right off of 275. And there is a buzz that's taking place. God is trying to really prime us and put us in place to do something far greater than we ever could have ever dreamed. Now, sometimes it seems like you're taking steps back when in reality you're just positioning yourself for something greater. I don't know if you watched the football game last night, but we won't talk a whole lot about the Buckeyes anymore. But I do know this, a lateral doesn't give you progress at the moment. And a lot of times the quarterback will even throw the ball back to someone back here. Now, logic would dictate, why in the world would you lose yards? When you're here, start from here and go. You know what I'm talking about? Does that not make sense? Logic would say, if I've got the ball on the 40, I'm not going to throw it back to the 35 and lose 5 yards. But we understand that when drawing up a play, sometimes you lose yards so that you can gain more yards. And that's exactly what happens sometimes in life. And in the church, God has to prune things back, prime us. But I believe that he is getting us ready. He's exposing the coals, bringing the right crowd around. We're going to pass the ball back. One of you going to run it for probably a couple touchdowns. I'm just sure of it. And I hope someone kicks it through the field goal and we get the extra points. God's going to do some great things, and I hope it turns out a lot better than what the Buckeyes did last night. Now, if you're an Alabama fan, then you got reason to rejoice today. Roll Tide. I got a good pastor friend down in Alabama. He's probably not watching right now, but he's in church. But if he watches this, my brother, roll on. You're going to do well. Ushers, I want you to get in place. Don't forget, we have church Wednesday night. Tonight we've been having tremendous services, and then a couple more things real quick. Saturday there's men's gathering at 8:30 here at the church, and then Saturday the 14th ladies gathering, and we're going to have a special speaker. Kim Collins will be speaking, and I've known Kim and her husband for many years. They've pastored and preached, and they travel all over the country right now. They're wonderful people. I've known them for probably 25 years, maybe, something of that nature. And they've known me, and they still love me after 25 years. So that says something about them still loving me after 25 years. But she is a dynamic, dynamic, Holy Ghost-filled woman of God, and you're going to want to be a part of that. Father, I pray that you'll bless this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. We're so excited to have our good pastor friends up from Georgia, Scott and Brittany. They're with us today. And Brittany and I have led worship for many years together. And I asked her to come and lead a chorus before pastor comes. But this isn't a spectator sport. We want you to worship. We're here to worship the Lord. So let's continue in worship.
As you worship the Lord this morning with your tithes and your offering, I was just thinking about the freedom, as we sang just a minute ago, that we have. And when I was thinking about this song, for me, freedom in the Lord is really knowing that we need Him more. To have freedom in Him is yielding to Him, because He gives us what we need, and sometimes we don't know what we need. And so this song has been so heavy in my spirit the last few days, and it is just coming out of a place of hunger and desire and knowing that I need Him. And I don't even know how much I need Him, but I know that I need Him more. Every day He's taken us through 2016. He's been faithful. No matter if you've gone through challenges, or no matter if you've overcome everything, or no matter if you were on a high all of 2016, we're in 2017 now, and He's still faithful, and we still need Him. So just come into worship now again, and let's sing to Him, I need you more. And don't sing it if you don't mean it. If you mean it, sing it to Him, because I know I need Him desperately. I need Him now more than ever. I need Him today more than yesterday. I'll need Him tomorrow more than today. So, Lord, I just thank You, and I lift You up. This morning, we thank You so much for Your presence, God. We thank You for Your glory, dear God. We thank You, dear Jesus, that You've heard our cry this morning, that You've met us here this morning, dear Jesus. God, we thank You for Your realness. God, we thank You for Your authenticity. God, we thank You that we know that You know every detail of our life, dear God. And so, Lord, right now, I pray right now that You would give each and every person a special touch from You, exactly what they need, dear God. Lord, I thank You, Jesus, and I praise Your name. Say I need You more.
read from Isaiah chapter 43. I'm going to have you stand and turn with me to Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 18. Isaiah 43, verse 18. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Now, I'm going to commit on this very first Sunday of the year, I'm going to commit the highest, most grievous atrocity that any pastor can ever attempt to do. And this could cause somebody to take a jackhammer to my name over in that new concrete. But I'm going to do it anyway. I just read that God is going to do a new thing. Now listen to me. If God's going to do a new thing, that means you're going to have to do a new thing. In life, in church, in ministry. So we're going to begin with just right now. I want everybody to move up. Move up a row of seats or so, a couple rows. Fill in the whole front of these seats. I want everyone to move. Now, here's what I'd like to see happen. I would like to see, this is going to be crazy, I would like to see some people. For example, young man, you sit right there every Sunday. I like the fact that you sit right there every Sunday. But I'm going to make you move all the way right there. Come on. I'm going to pick on them. I'm going to make you move all. You guys aren't moving yet. Just pick up your purse and move. I'm doing this for a reason. I'm doing it. Just everyone, all you in the back, just move. And Now listen. If all you do is move over one seat, just move. Oh, this is good. Move. Paul, you didn't move. You guys exchange seats. Just. Everybody move. Everybody move. Everybody move. Now, while you're doing, just look at your neighbor and say, isn't this crazy what the preacher's doing today? Just move out of those back. There ain't nobody. There's enough room for everyone. Look at this. Everybody move. Everybody move. Wait a minute. You're not sitting where I told you to sit. I'm teasing. Your wife said to sit there. Now listen to me. I want you to hear me. Sometimes you got to force the issue. The issue is this. If you stay where you've always been, you will get what you've always got. You hear me? In life, in ministry, in the church, if you stay where you've always been, you're going to get what you've always got. And God has a new thing for you in 2017. Lord, I pray that each and every one of us will move forward. That each and every one of us will move up. That each and every one of us will have a complete and absolute expectation that you are going to do a new thing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want you close to somebody. Oh, yeah. Thank you for doing that. Now, let me ask you one question before I preach. Do you still love me? Yes. That was not convincing. Do you still love me? Yes. That's good, because I just read in the Bible last night, thou shalt love Troy Price Ervin. It's right in there. God says to Isaiah, I'm going to do a new thing. Now, I want you to hear me. Before he ever makes this great announcement that he's going to do something new, he gives a warning. He says, remember not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Remember not the former things, neither consider the things of old.
And then God speaks with clear, concise terms when he says, I will do. The question isn't whether God will do it. I will do a new thing. It will spring forth. And here's the question. It's an important question. He asked, will you not know it? Will you not know when I do a new thing? Now, Mike, you were sitting back there, and you normally sit right there. You went back to the old thing. You were doing a new thing, and you went to... What is going on with you, Mike? You're trying... I'll give you a new thing to do, Mike. Just one time this basketball season, root for the Buckeyes. You can't do that, can you? I had to pick on Mike a second. God says, I will with certainty do a new thing. It will spring forth. Will you not know it? Everyone say revelation. Now, I'm going to tell you the enemy of the new thing. You know what it is? The old thing. Now, when I say the old thing, I mean the old things that are bad, the old things that are good. All the old things are enemies to the new thing. Because each and every one of us, especially the older we get, we have a tendency to revert back to the old thing. It's just invariable. There's something about getting older that causes you to talk about yesterday. There's just something about it. I don't know what it is. I know that I'm the same way. I have a tendency to talk about yesterday. And I will say some of the things from yesterday are probably better than some of the things for today. I mean, I've got to be honest. I like some of the yesterday things, as I would say it, the good old days. I like some of them. You know, I went to the filling station or the gas station not long ago. I mean, I put the card in. I'm hitting the no. I finally look at the pump and say, can I just get gas? I don't want a car wash. I don't want this. I just want. And then I got to go in and do you swipe it? Do you put the card, insert the card? Does it have the chip? All those kind of things. And I said to the lady, she was a lot younger than me, I said, you know, I remember when I was younger, they told me computers were going to make things simpler. But when I was younger, I can remember even 16 years old when I first got my license, pulling into the gas station and a guy would come out. He would put the pump in the car. He would fill my car with the fuel. He would walk over to my window and say, let me do something. And he would wipe my window and clean it. He would open the hood. He would check the oil, put air in the tires. He'd say, would you like any chips or something to drink? Yes, sir. He would go back in the store and bring them to me. I would give him the money and pull out. Seems to me that was a lot easier. Now we're living in the good old days of cell phones. And I've got to be honest, they aggravate me to death, cell phones. You know what, not that we have them. What aggravates me is I used to pick up a phone that was on a wire and make a phone call and someone would answer, or at least... You know, I can remember back in the 80s and 90s, at least they had answering machines that you could leave a message. Now everybody's got cell phones on their hip, in their pocket, in their hand, looking at it all the time, and you call them and they never answer. Never. It makes me so mad. I want to send a text and say, are you really going to ignore me? I know you're looking at your phone, Mandy. There are some good old things about the past, I'll admit. That I don't know that I like some of the new so well. But the reality is, to give way to the new, you have to forget the past. Now, you can still go out and buy some nostalgic things. And I enjoy that. You know, I've got a record player. It's nothing like putting a good old record on every now and then. Hear the scratching of the needle. You know, that's back when music was music. Not all the techno lights, people that couldn't sing and they made them sound like they could sing. I'm not talking about all that stuff. I'm talking about just music. Actual voices, actual people playing the guitar, actual, you understand what I'm saying? Back when the scratches were on the record and it would get stuck and you'd have to hit that thing. I mean, that's music, children. I remember the good old days of an 8-track player in my 1977 Dodge Monaco with the moon rims, and I'd put that Merle Haggard 8-track in. Listen to Merle sing, and the thing would start to and you'd take a book of matches and shove it under there to get that thing to, you know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about, old people. I have to admit, I do like, you know, having music on your phone. You know, no book of matches, no skipping of the, you know, no. That's a good thing. No, you see, chances are you're not going to go buy an 8-track today. It's not going to happen. It won't be long. CDs will be completely obsolete, you know? And I remember when they first started. Remember the tapes? I mean, let's just be real. In order to give way to the new, the old must go. So God says, forget about what has been. He said, don't even consider it. Now, there are two things in the past I don't want you to consider today. Number one, I don't want you to consider your sins and your failures in the past. What happened yesterday has no bearing on what God will do with you today. You hear me? If you live in the failures of your past, then all you'll do is completely and continue to repeat those failures. Don't worry about it. I don't care how many times you fall, God will pick you up. You hear me? I don't care how many times you mess up, God will clean up the mess. That's the God that we serve. He told Peter to forgive 70 times 7, and he'll do the same. Quit wallowing in what has happened. Don't waller in that no more. There's no need to do that. Let me tell you something. If you messed up and just outright sinned today, and you ask God to forgive you, he is so gracious and kind, and when he forgives us, forgets about our sin. If tomorrow you messed up and did the same thing and said, God, I did it again, he'd say, did what? Because he didn't remember. What. Now, that's not a license for you to do whatever you want. I'm just simply saying you don't have to live in the failures of the past. But I'm going to be honest with you. That's not what I want to preach about. I'm going to spend a moment here, and then I'm going to get to the new thing. Here's the biggest problem. My failures have never been my downfall. It's not my failures that hold me back. So I understand God's grace. I appreciate it. It's normally not the failures that keep us back. It's the successes. It is the experiences that we had. And it is the natural tendency, just like when you come to church every Sunday and Bob sits right there. And Mandy sits right there and Shannon sits right there. Physically, we do it. Just like Paul sits right there every Sunday. Same old. Same old. Haven't you ever said that to someone? Well, how's it going? Well, just same old, same old. I don't know about anybody else. I just have to speak for me right now. But I am up to my eyebrows, sick and tired of the same old, same old. And the problem is, even when we say we want God to do a new thing, all we want is a better version of the old thing. I'm preaching good right now. We get in our head just what it's going to be. And if we can just get God, if you can just do. And I remember that experience I had. Ten years ago, fifteen years ago, whatever it may have been. Wasn't that wonderful? Wasn't that glorious? I'm going to tell you what. The hardest day of the year to preach is when New Year's Day falls on Sunday. You all drank too much last night. That's the problem. You better not have. Do you remember that experience? See, we all have that knee-jerk natural reaction, even when it comes to God. To reach back in the annals of our life. I've seen it in a spiritual sense. I've seen it in the natural. In every sense of the word, we do it. We reach back in what has happened, what we've done, what we've experienced, what we've succeeded at. We reach back and we take hold of that and we lift that toward heaven. And basically we say, okay, God, I know you're going to do a new thing. Can you make it look something like this with a different suit of clothing on? God says, I'm going to do a new thing. Will you know it? Will you even know when I do it? You know what I contend? I contend that more times than not, Troy Ervin, and I can put your name in the blank too, I contend that more times than not, most of us completely and totally miss what God is doing. Because we are trying to drum up somehow an experience from the past. Somewhere along the line, we've got to ask God to somehow give us eyes, ears, and hearts that are keen and acute to revelation, to something new that God wants to do. If there's anything I've learned about God through the years, and I've been in church all my life, I've been preaching now for 28 years. Doesn't look like it, I know, but it started when I was 2.5, 3. So it was right around there somewhere. The thing I've learned about God is he very rarely does the same thing twice. The end result's the same. He wants to use your life in a tremendous way. He wants to bless your life in 2017. There's going to be opportunities come your way, and I'm going to talk about all that. But the end result of God is always the same. Lives changed. You know, what he wants to do with Life Change Church? See people saved and healed and delivered and helped. The end result's the same. But God very rarely gets there the same way. In the Old Testament, God parted waters 3 times. And every time he parted them, he did it different. Remember when the children of Israel with Moses stood at the Red Sea? And they were coming against Moses. And you remember what happened. Moses says to God, what am I going to do? And God says, here's what I want you to do. Just tell everybody to stand still and see my salvation. And so the children of Israel, they stood at the Red Sea. And Moses took that holy stick that he'd been carrying and lifted it out over the water, and they did nothing, said nothing. They just stood there, and suddenly God did a miracle when he pushed back the waters of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel, 2 million of them, walked across on dry land. God parted the waters. Everybody say this with me. God that I serve,
is a standing God.
He was that day. Stand to God. Oh, hallelujah. The God that I serve is a standing God. Years ago, you ever been down in the hills of Kentucky and West Virginia and Southeast Ohio where there's a bunch of hacking preachers? Years ago, there was an old guy that had a cold and a little bit of pneumonia, and he decided to preach anyway, and he couldn't get his breath, and he was one of the great preachers in the hills, and he started hacking when he was preaching. And he couldn't hardly get his breath, so he kept preaching. He started hacking, and someone thought, well, that's a spiritual thing, so they started hacking even when they didn't need to. That's the truth. I've seen them hold their ear. I want to tell you right now, God said, God, and deep in Kentucky, they got a big chaw of tobacco in there. A spit tune right over by the pulpit, and a gossip ping. Some of them preachers, man, they had that thing guided like a missile. They could hit that spit tune just about anywhere. Now, I'm not going to encourage you to hack or chew tobacco. Nothing wrong with hacking. If you want to hack when you preach, I've never been much of a hacking preacher. God that I serve is a standing God. But 40 years later, Joshua is standing at the swelling tide of the Jordan. It's high tide. It's springtime. And God says, I want you to go take the promised land. The first obstacle is the Jordan River. And so Joshua goes to God, and God says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get the Ark of the Covenant, and I want you to get the priest, and I want them to go first and bear the Ark of the Covenant. And when their foot hits the brim of the water, tell them to step. And when the foot hits the brim of the waters will part, and I'll do a miracle. Joshua could have said, oh, I want to tell you right now, God that I serve. Never heard about this God. I don't know what you're talking about. This don't seem like God to me. Because I remember I was a young man. I remember when I used to go to church. I remember when I used to go to camp meeting. I remember when I used to go to revival. I remember old brother so-and-so did this. Sister so-and-so did that. Let me reach back and tell you, God's servant Moses, he didn't step, he stood. So I might be getting confused. I might be getting messed up here because I remember. Had he reached back in his experiences, right, and waited for God to do what he had done, he'd still be standing there. At least their ashes would be there. No, they needed a fresh revelation. God said, I want you to step. Remember Elijah? Yeah. He came to the Jordan one day. He's going to go across, and God spoke to him and said, I want you to take your mantle and strike. Elijah could have said, I remember the story. When we used to gather around the campfire, Grandpa would tell me about the stories of God's people. He told about the Red Sea. You guys are bored out of your silly minds, but that's all. He told us about the Red Sea and how they stood and God parted the waters. He told us about Joshua, that great conquering leader, when they were going to go into the land of promise, and they come to the Jordan and they stepped. Now this striking God, never heard of this God before in my life. I'm not sure about this God. This don't make much sense to me because the God that I remember, let me reach back in the stories I've heard about what God did. And what I hear about what God used to do is he always stood and he always stepped. I don't know much about a striking God, but I know something about no. The revelation was strike.
God said, I will do a new thing. Are you going to stand? Are you going to step? Are you going to strike? You may not do any of it. The greatest detriment to our lives and the greatest detriment to the forward action of his kingdom, the greatest detriment to the church, the greatest detriment in our... We can't seem to forget about what happened. Bad and good. We can't seem to let go of what so-and-so did to us, the bad thing, and we can't seem to let go of all the great things that God's done. Somewhere, we've got to obey the word of God and say, God, I'm going to forget the former things. Because God says, I am going to do a new thing. I wonder what that would look like. Do you know why we live out of the past? You know why? I'm going to tell you why. You know why we live out of the past? Are you ready? I'm going to tell you why we live. You know why we live out of the past? It's easier. Right. It's easier. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. You've heard that one? I see some old dogs in here. You can't teach an... It's easier to live out of what's been because we're already familiar. We've already experienced it. We're already comfortable with it. We're already... attuned and adept. We're already, it's so much easier to live out of what's been. We get to the place we don't, it doesn't matter. We like the old, like my old recliner. I don't want a new recliner. They pick on me about my old junk. It looks awful. But you want to hear something funny? I have to kick everybody out of it. They pick on me about my old recliner, but I have to kick them out. Huh? We like the old stuff. It's easier. You know what? These boots I've got on, I love these boots. They're so comfortable. I love these boots so much. I went out and bought a brand new pair of boots exactly like these. I mean, identical. Same brand, same size, same color, same everything. I went and bought a brand new pair of boots just like these boots. You know when I did it? When these wore out on the bottom. But you know what I done? I wore the new boots one day while I was getting new soles put on these boots. And the brand new boots are sitting in my basement for whenever I have to get these boots resoled again. And then Why? You can't beat an old pair of boots. They're just comfortable. These boots are more comfortable than tennis shoes. I want to tell you, I feel so good when I wear these boots. I'm at the place, they're kind of scuffed up right now. I don't even care how they look. I mean, they're just so comfortable, and they're formed to my foot. I don't have to work to take them off, and I don't have to work to put them on. They just slide right on and slide right off. I got one of those boot horns. You know what I'm talking about? You step on it and you pull your boot off. I got other boots. I got to use the boot horn. Every time I try to, I'm squeezing them things, and they hurt my feet, and I'm walking around like this all day. I want to tell you, these things are so, they feel so comfortable, and I don't have to boot horn it or nothing. I can take them, I don't even have to use my hands. I can just slide that boot right off there. Right there. Look at that. I mean to tell you, that's something. I can put that right back down there, hike my little leg up. I can put that on there. Just so simple. It's just so easy. I don't even have to think about it. Throw my jeans over top. Maybe I'll just shove them down in because Mandy thinks that looks stupid. I mean to tell you, don't that look good? I mean to tell you, I love these boots, Tom, because they're so comfortable.
the moment in life, the moment in your life, the moment in this church, the moment, because of our levels of comfort, the moment we won't wear the new boots is the moment we stop progressing. And it's in that moment. We may not miss God that day, but it's in that moment we have positioned ourselves to totally and completely miss God.
Right.
Spiritually, we can look back at camp meetings and revivals, read books, and think, boy, I want to wear those boots. But those boots weren't made for this day. They were made for that day. I want to tell you, you can take your club and beat that dead horse until you're blue in the face, but that thing ain't never getting up again. God says, I've got a new one to ride. You hear me? God says, I got a new one to ride. Same way in your life. Now, I know with some of your clothing, they come back around. God doesn't come. The end result's always the same. He's going to part waters. He's going to get his glory. And things are going to happen in a great way in your life and in the church. But the reality is, you'll never experience any of it if all you do is resole your old boots.
Right.
What we have experienced cannot be the totality of what God is going to do. God says, I am going to do a new thing. I wonder what that's going to look like for us this year. I wonder what that's going to look like for you in your life. Are you going to live another year and just say, same old, same old? You're going to pick up a dream God gave you. Are you going to accept a new challenge in your life? Are you just going to be same old, same old? You're going to be the same old husband, same old wife, same old preacher, same old worship leader, same old organist, playing the same old thing, or really not really playing anything. Just going to do the same old. You're going to do the same old thing? Same old, same old, same old. Let me ask you this. Are you going to live in the same old cycles of life? Walk around the same old mountain? Same old problems? Have the same old experience again? Is that what we're going to do? Or are we going to say, God, what are you going to do? What do you want to do in Troy Price Ervin's life in 2017? For the Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered of God. What do you want to do in Troy Price Ervin's life? What opportunities are you going to give me? And am I going to be bold enough and brave enough to let go of what I've had and what I've been and let it all fall away and say, God, whatever it costs, whatever it looks like, whatever it means, however irritable it becomes, how uncomfortable it is at times, I am going to accept the new challenge that you've given me for my life, for my ministry, for my family, whatever it may be. I don't care how unrestful it is. Listen, every time God does a new thing, there is unrest. It's uncomfortable. It don't fit right yet. This doesn't fit right. But I want to tell you, it is right. God's trying to push you past where you've always been. What are you going to do? What are you going to do?
Same old, same old. Now, I've been pastoring for too long. I want to tell you something. There are times I deal with people and I think, why do you just want to do the same old thing? Why? Why do you want to stay right there? God's got something better. Why are you doing this? Why are you staying right there? I'll just give you some of my fed ups. I get fed up. I'm a dad. I get fed up. You know? I get fed up. I talk to people and they say, well, I know God really wants this. And then they come to church and they don't do it. They say, well, I'm really trying. No, you're not trying, or you'd have done it. Huh? Amen? It's going over like a lead balloon. That's all right. I don't need your amens. I like them, but I don't have to have them to give truth. You have done, the some of you have done the same thing, sit in the same seat, had the same demeanor, done the same thing for 20 years. And the whole time God is saying, I have something new for you. Forget the old. Embrace the new. Can you imagine what he can do in your life this year? I remember, I'll let you go. I remember when I first started preaching and little doors were opening here and there. I was preaching some services. I was getting some big gigs at 18. I had my first gig was Zion Number 3 Church. I've never been to Zion Number 3 Church. Zion Number 3 Church. Can I tell you a little bit about Zion Number 3 Church? Zion Number 3 Church has about 15, 20 people in them still today. Zion Number 3 Church. When they call for the choir, 15 people go up on stage and 5 people are still out there. And choir is the special number at Zion Number 3 Church. That's the special. They don't have a special singer normally. This the choir sings. And really all it is another congregational song with them standing on the platform. Zion Number 3 Church. Wonderful people at Zion Number 3 Church. I love Zion. This is the first place I ever preached in my life was Zion Number 3 Church. And then they'll ask for testimonies at Zion Number 3 Church. And they'll keep asking until finally someone gets up and bawls and squalls around about something they should have never talked about in church. You've been there, haven't you? Elder Shannon, you've been there. Not Zion Number 3, but one just like it. I'm going to tell you, I could go to Zion Number 3 Church this morning, and they'd be doing the same thing they were doing when I was 18 years old, and there'd be 20 people there. Hear me? It's getting real quiet. There'd be 20 people there. They'd call for the choir, and 15 will go up. The 5 that don't feel like they can sing will stay back and listen. And the 15 that went up can't sing either. You know what I'm saying? Wonderful people that, listen, they're going to heaven. They love Jesus. But the reality is at Zion Number 3, one time, listen, one time God did something at Zion Number 3. I remember I was about 20 years old. A revival broke out at Zion Number 3. And what I mean by revival, it wasn't some hilarious expression. I mean, it within a month, about 30 people got saved. It just, God said, I'm going to do something new at Zion Number 3. Listen to me. God did it. And it was different than they'd ever experienced. They actually had me come out and sing and preach. And you know what they did? They started to call for the choir and they started all that stuff. And someone said, why don't we just have Troy sing and then preach instead of doing what we always do? And they said, okay, let's do that. So I got up and preached and sang. It was good. No, not the preaching and singing. It was good that I didn't have to sit there and listen to that choir. I tell you, the altars are lined every night for weeks It went for about 4 weeks, every single night. And people got saved. Now listen to me. Of those 30, 40 people, families, I know some of them that got saved. Listen to me. As soon as that stopped, you know what Zion number 3 did? Exactly what they're doing right now. And not one single person that was saved in that revival is still going to Zion number 3 church. They still got their 20 people, and they're older now, and the 15 people go up. I think you're getting what I'm trying to tell you. All they did after God did a new thing was reach back and grab a hold of what God had done with them 40 years ago. And it stopped the progression of that church in its tracks. And it stopped what God was trying to do with Zion number 3 church in its tracks. Do you hear me? The greatest detriment to your life, the greatest detriment to our church, the greatest detriment to progressing is regressing. People say, but this defines who we are. No, what should define who we are is the presence of God, period. What should define me as a man tomorrow morning isn't what I've done for 40 years. No, it's who I am with God that day. We've got to get it in our head. We cannot live out of what has been. Yeah, I've got to let you go. It's 11:22. I didn't mean to preach this long, but I'm not going to take one word of it back. Not one word. Except for the one about new boots. I'm going to keep my old ones. Listen to me. I appeal to your heart. I appeal to your spirit as an individual. God in 2017 is going to do something new with you. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. It's going to be good. Don't miss it. And I appeal to our church. God in 2017 is going to do something new with Life Change Church. We've had some glorious days in the past. And I am not beating my head against the wall trying to repeat what he did 10 years ago or 12 years ago at this church when we have multiple services and all that. I am not going to be that. I don't want to be what we have been. I want to be what God wants us to be right now. You understand me? What God wants, not what we're comfortable with, not with the boots that we wear. What does God want? And it might just rub you a little bit when God does it. He just has a way of doing that, pushing at you and jabbing you a little bit. It's a wonderful thing because he's trying to get you someplace to experience and do something we've never done. Life Change Church is on the brink of doing what we've never done before. Let's not miss it. Let's not miss it. I first started preaching. I had some experiences early on, and I went to God, and I said, God, if I can just be this. And there was a little fella running around Wellston. He preached a lot at Zion number 3, and he could play the piano pretty good. And he was a good preacher. Worked over at Mead Paper. Good fella. Known to this day, love him to this day. And when I first started preaching, I said, God, if I can just be that. I went and applied at Mead Paper. I could play the piano kind of similar to him, a little better, but I could play the piano similar to him. I'm just teasing. And I said, God, if I can just have me a little church around Wellston and do these revivals around here like he does, then that's what I had seen, experienced, been around. Let me have that. And I did that for a little while. I didn't work at Mead Paper, but I did that for a little while. And one day, I was a sophomore in college. I was working. I was preaching little meetings around there. And God spoke to me as I was driving to college. He said, Troy, I'd like to do a new thing with you. I said, well, God, what do you mean you'd like to do a new thing? He said, I'd like to do a new thing. I said, all right.
He said, I want you to go this year, and I want you, he wouldn't tell too many people this, but he said, I want you to quit the job that you're working. Go to college full time, get you a full slate at school, and trust me. Trust me. I said, okay, God, I will. Let me tell you something. From my sophomore year to my senior year, I held nearly 130 revivals in camp meetings. And for 10, 12 years, I went all over the world preaching in revivals and camp meetings. Now, that was then. That's not today. You don't have too many of those things today. That's just not as much as it used to be. A lot of people keep trying to repeat it, but it just ain't happening. It just ain't happening right now like it did. But what I'm trying to explain, in that moment, God said, oh, my sophomore year, I want to do a new thing. And he jarred me into thinking and looking for him different than what I had been for a couple years. Do you hear what I'm saying? And from that moment until this, I want to tell you what he's done in my life and where he's taken me and what we've done in ministry, far completely, it blows my mind to even think about what he's done the last 20-some years in my life. Had I not found the new thing he was trying to do with Troy Ervin, you know where I would be? I'd be running around Wellston, preaching revivals at Zion number 3, maybe pastoring the little Methodist church up on the hill where my Uncle Troy is buried right out there. That's exactly where I would be. Instead, you know where I am? I know you don't like it, but I'm right here with you. I am right here at Life Change Church. Listen. And listen to me, I made up my mind from my sophomore year to this year. My sophomore year of college, when I was just a kid, till I'm 45 years old, I made up my mind I will never settle in to what I've always had. That's whenever God spoke to me, when I'd drive by that building over on 275, where people say, you're nuts. You've got a great church and great property and all those things. What in the world? And I mean, I wrestled with God for 2 years, and God said, I want to do a new thing with Life Change Church. Will you listen to me? I want to do a new thing. Talk to the elders. I want to do a new thing. I'm not doing that over there out of some vain glory. I didn't want to do it. I had everything fixed up pretty good right here. Doing 3 services, great crowd, and God said, I want you to trim it down to 1, and I want you to get ready for something new. And I said, God, I might lose everything. He said, well, it ain't yours to begin with. Huh? People gonna think you're crazy. I got news for you. I am crazy. I am a loon. I'm a nut. Huh? I thought for sure you'd say amen right there. Huh? No, I am crazy enough to never settle in. And where spiritually and in life, proverbially, I refuse to keep wearing the same old boots because they're comfortable. No, God has something big. God has something great. And I've got good news for you. He's going to have to bless every one of you in a big way to make it happen. He's going to bless you in your mind, in your heart, in your finances, in your spirit, in your family. He's going to bring us together in a powerful way, and we're going to step out of the old. And in 2017, we're going to step into the new, and God's going to move in a powerful way. Can you even begin to imagine what it's going to be like? Woo, I'm excited. I can't wait for the new. I'll tell you the best thing I ever did do is I took off them old boots and I put on the new. Get ready. Get ready. God says, I'm going to do a new thing. I'm not going to live out of what's been. All right. Everybody stand with me. I got to quit. I've got so much I can preach right now. I got to quit. Good night. I love preaching the first day of the year. I love you. Someone said they love me. I appreciate this so much. I want to ask you something. Are you ready for something new in your life?
Just look at your neighbor and say, God's doing something new with you. Lord Jesus, this is not one of those altar call sermons. It's just simply an encouragement for everybody to get their eyes open and say, God, what are you going to do new with me? Lord, I thank you that everybody in this place changed their seat a little bit ago. And I pray that everybody in this place will do the same thing in their life this year. You want to do something new, and I ask that every one of us will see it and know it. Now, God, if there's someone here that needs to pray, if there's someone here that doesn't know you as their Savior, if there's someone here that needs help, needs encouragement, needs healing, whatever it may be, I pray that they'll have the courage to step out of their seat at the close of this service and come and kneel right here or stand, and we're going to pray with them before we go home. If anyone needs to pray, as he sings, why don't you just step out and come, and we'll make that our closing prayer.
Anybody like that? Moving ahead, here to declare to you, my past is over in you, all things are made new, surrender my life to Christ, I'm moving, I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead, here to declare to you, my past is over in you, all things are made new.
Put them up there. Sing us some more.
I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead.
We'll move ahead.
I'm here to declare
to you. Everybody ready to get a new life.
My past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving. I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead. Over in you, all things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving.
Ready to move forward.
Moving forward. You made all things new. Yes, you made all things new. And I will follow. Over in you, all things to make new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward.
Happy New Year. It's going to be the best year. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. Oh, may your blessing be upon each one as we leave this place in Jesus' name.